We have been for the past month in a sermon series called Deeper Conversations. And our goal in that was to do a couple things. We wanted to help people think about what do other people believe? I find that in America, we often treat religion off limits. Christians do that with each other, right? That's just stunning to me, that Christians sometimes make religion off limits. Well, if we do that interfaith, imagine what we do that, if we do that within our own faith, imagine what we do that with the faith of others. And so what we wanted to do is to do some very basic education, and it's been very basic, around, we start with Roman Catholicism, because we thought, you know what, we can limber up on that. That shouldn't be that hard. Then we went to Judaism, and that's, again, that's, not that far off. Christians are accustomed to the Hebrew Bible. Then we went to Islam, and then today, Barbara did just a wonderful job talking about Hinduism. And so in each time, we've tried to tell you a little bit about the faith, and part of this is we want you to be good neighbors. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. That's a pivotal aspect of Judaism. And so Jews and Christians agree on that, and I believe other faith traditions agree on that as well. And here in Northern Virginia, our neighbors, if you're going to know your neighbors, you have to know other faith traditions. So we've been trying to do some basic education to help you with that. But the other thing is, you'll never know your own faith until you're able to contrast it with someone else's. And contrast doesn't have to mean disagreement or argument or ugliness. It just means that we believe some different things, and let's own that. Shaun was invited by Secretary Kerry to create the office that he's been in. So tell us, why was this seen as a need? And essentially, what was your role in the role of, because you had a large, you had a department of people. So talk to us about that.
Well, I had the privilege of meeting John Kerry in 2005 after he had lost the presidential race. And in the intervening 8 years, we had kind of a casual running conversation about religion in American politics, but we also discovered we had an interest in religion in American foreign policy. And I helped him write some speeches. We'd get together once in a while. And one of the things that happens to you when they name you Secretary of State is an army of lawyers run at you immediately, which is kind of a scary picture. And they tell you, Mr. Secretary, you can do these 10 things, but you can't do those. And one of the things he was told by one of these advisors was, you have the legal authority to launch a religion advisory office on your staff, in your bureau. And as the story was told to me, he interrupted the briefer and he turned to his chief of staff, who I've also known since 2005, and he said, David, call Shaun and see if he can twist his arm into taking this job. And so almost exactly 4 years ago, I went into work one Friday morning at Wesley, opened up my email, and there was an email from David, the chief of staff, like from 5 a.m. And he said, Shaun, can you come see me tonight after work? And you know, my wife's a negotiator and is a business consultant. I counted to 10. And I put, I think I can fit you in tonight, David. Anyway, I didn't do that, but I went down. One of the things, and so I went down and had a discussion with the chief of staff about this conversation Kerry had had. And Secretary Kerry had always had this intuition that we had made some very bad mistakes diplomatically and politically in our foreign policy because out of our willful ignorance of lived religion, particularly in the Muslim world. And had we been smarter, perhaps we could have made some smarter decisions about what to do and what not to do in the Middle East. And he asked me then to take this intuition of his that the State Department had been very reticent in talking about religion, talking about the political implications of lived religion. And he asked me basically to build an office around that intuition and find ways that I could advise him, how I could help our 275 posts, embassies and consulates around the world engage religious actors in their particular zip code more effectively, and then be the point of contact for any religious community or religious actor or scholar of religion to see how they might be able to collaborate with the American government to be successful on a number of issues of mutual interest.
Mm-hmm. So talk just a little bit more, and by the way, I think this is going to last about an hour to an hour and 15 minutes, which in general for Tom Berlin time is how everything should last, about that time frame. And you may have a question, and we've got some folks in the back that if you put your hand up during this time, they will bring you a note card. and you can write your question on the note card. They'll have a pen, and then they're going to gather those. My experience is we never get in all the questions, so it's no guarantee. But if he says something that you think, I want to ask a question, just be aware you can do that. I think it's really important for people to understand about religion just to live in this community. Northern Virginia is very, very diverse, but of course, when we talk about the globe, religions is a lot. Can you talk just a little bit more about why you think it's important for the U.S. government to understand the context of religion and the cultures that we interact with as a nation?
I think historically our government has been very reticent. As one friend of mine says, and this is true of both political parties, there's no immunity to this, that State Department officials and a lot of senior government officials get, as she put it, twitchy when the subject of religion comes up. And it's one of those topics where, you know, if you take the average Foreign Service officer who's dedicated his or her career to working in foreign policy, they know history, they are multilingual, they have lived all over the world, they know economics, they know politics, they know culture. And yet when they come to religion, they tend to freeze because they've never been rewarded professionally for understanding religion. In fact, they try to shunt you off into the side in a couple of ghost offices that aren't necessarily central to our foreign policy. And yet they will all admit that in recent decades we've made terrible blunders in our foreign policy because we didn't have the depth of knowledge. Madeleine Albright wrote a great book a few years ago called The Mighty and the Almighty after she retired as Secretary of State, and she said, I could snap my fingers in an instant, get a dozen advisors on any topic around the world, economics, policy, military, but she said, when religion came up, there was nobody for me to call. And in retrospect, she said, I made mistakes. And so she was one of the early advocates for the State Department to get smarter. But it's one thing, I mean, you know this from your pastoral work. It's one thing for a person to say, I have a problem. It's quite another to say, well, here's the remedy for that problem. Here's what I need to do to change my life. So the State Department, I think, realized they didn't have a very deep grasp of religion because it's so complicated, it's so controversial. I was the guy they hired to come in and come up with the answer to that. And I remember very, very vividly once I was sworn in and I had my security background check, they put me what they call in a transition office, which is really more of a cage than an office. And they eventually move you upstairs to where you're going to be. And I remember thinking, oh, this is great. And then this is not great because I have a blank piece of paper. No one has ever done this before, and suddenly I've got to try and build an office and highlight and identify the specific issue areas where building stronger ties with religious communities would actually lead to a more robust a foreign policy. And that was very haunting and very intimidating, but then I started hiring people who knew the power of religious actors in religious communities around the world for good and for ill. And I think that's what makes it so complicated, is that religion is what a professor of mine called a multivalent force. Now, there's some people who think religion always messes things up. There's some people who think religion always cures things. I've been around the block enough to know that it's neither one of those. It's a messier middle where religious communities are capable of doing amazing things and motivating people to do just incredibly constructive things. And I can talk about some specific areas. But we also know from the headlines from the last decade, religiously motivated people are also capable of doing horrific things. And I had to build an office of people who knew how to address that full scope and range of the implications of lived religion around the globe.
So how did you do the educational, how did your office do the educational piece with members of the State Department? How did you all carry out that mission?
Well, the first thing I did is I had to figure out how to configure the office. You know, there are 7 billion people in the world, and Pew Research has shown that somewhere around 84% of those people express some loyalty or affiliation to a specific religious community. So the size is daunting, and if there's 7 billion people, I often joke there are 70 billion forms of religiosity around the world. All of the major world religions are internally plural. So if somebody comes to you and says, well, Tom, tell us, give us a one-paragraph description of what Christianity is, At first, you would speak out of your own experience, but you suddenly realize there are going to be tribes and different denominations at different locations around the world that would argue with you and say that that's not what Christianity is about. So I had to hire a staff. We built a staff of 30 people, and I hired people who knew what I didn't know. I hired people who understood lived Islam and all of its complexity around the world. I hired people who understood Judaism, who understood Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, and we built this amazing staff. And we had to collaborate with scholars and other communities because you could have a group of 30 people and there's no way we could pretend to know all of the power of religion around the world because it's so complex and so pervasive. But once I built the staff, I empowered them to go out and try to identify the foreign policy issues where religious communities could partner with us, where they were in deep disagreement, and then we looked at the secretary's priorities and we tried to align our priorities with his. Because if you're reporting directly to the chief of staff every week and they say, well, what are you doing? You're writing your weekly action reports. If my work didn't correspond to the work of my boss, I knew I was going to be short-lived.
So just because I think I'm longing for some good news right now, tell us some of those good things that religion accomplished. You said that earlier. You said, I've got some things that I can tell you about. Let me hear, I mean, I've got a bunch of questions for you, but let me hear about some of those.
Well, let me tell you three areas where I think we did remarkable work. There's a longer list of where we didn't have a lot of success, but maybe we circle back to some of that. As you remember, at the beginning of Secretary Kerry's tenure, there was this global climate treaty process going that was moving towards a meeting in Paris in December of 2015, where the world came together and forged this amazing agreement addressing climate change and mitigating and adapting to that. So when I landed there, I knew the American scene where there were really sort of three different communities involved in trying to make this a success. There were the negotiators inside the State Department who were at the table with 120 other countries trying to come to this global agreement. And these were people who were scientists, they were politicians, and our policy people. They didn't know the religious world. For the most part, they were secular folk. But they knew we had to convince a variety of communities in the United States if we were going to come to a successful agreement. And the chief negotiator told me one time, he said, Shaun, there are three groups that can help us. If we convince the business community, the security community, and the faith community in the United States, we'll get a great agreement. And when he told me that, the faith community is part of that, I almost passed out because I had no idea he had any understanding of the religious world. Now, I knew then the two other groups, there were an amazing array of American religious groups who were advocating for a very strong treaty. But they were very skeptical of the negotiators inside the State Department. They thought, you guys want an agreement so bad, you're going to settle for a lousy agreement and sell us out because failure is going to kill your careers. And so there was deep skepticism among the government relations folk. You know, the United Methodist Church has the Church of Borden Society that advocates for policies, and there just about every other religious group you can imagine in the United States has a similar group of people advocating, and they all wanted a really tough climate treaty and thought we in the State Department were going to sell them out.
Yeah, I want to correct you for just a second. It's actually the Board of Church and Society, but we have been the Church of Board and Society. We have been that. But I just want to make sure if you're not one of us that
yeah. He can say that. Yeah. I couldn't say that. But then you had the secular environmental groups like I'm blanking on the names. Sierra Club is one of the big wigs. They were hoping, too, for a very strong treaty. And frankly, they had their doubts about the State Department like the religious groups did. But the religious groups and the secular groups didn't get along. Because the secular groups said, we just want you guys when it's time to add, we want your mailing lists. We don't want to hear your theology about why you should care for the environment. And the religious group said, we want to be at the table talking about how to get the best treaty. So I knew all this, so I convened a three-way meeting of senior leaders from the religious groups, from the secular groups, and the senior policy people in the Obama administration working on climate. And I said, I have a thesis, I have a theory. My theory is there's tension in every direction among these three parties. And it wasn't quite like marital counseling, but I simply sort of said, can this marriage be saved? And so I threw my thesis out, and I'm sitting in this room with like 40 high-powered people. Total silence, crickets, but eyes darting around the table like, yes, this guy has just told the truth, and I'm gonna have to fess up. And then suddenly one guy raised his hand from, I think it was the Sierra Club, and he said, Shaun, you're right. We look at the religious groups and we want their mailing list. We don't want to hear their theology. You know, that's just, that makes us uncomfortable. And then he looked at the negotiators and he said, yeah, we have our doubts about you guys. We don't think you're going to give us the best possible treaty. So they then an amazing conversation broke out where everybody agreed that in order to get to a successful treaty in Paris in about a year and a half, these three constituencies were going to have to come together and find a way to work together. And I created the platform where these people talked. I didn't direct it. I didn't have the technical expertise on the policy side. And I knew I didn't have the political will or power to sort of coerce them into something. But what I did, sometimes you play a role of convener, whether it's all religious groups or it's religious groups and secular groups. And that's what I did. I created space in the next year and a half, and then about a month and a half before the Paris negotiations actually formally started in Paris, I brought them all back together, and it was like a love end. They were hugging each other. They had come to an agreement amongst themselves. And so the distrust went away. But the faith groups played a very important part in bridging the gap between the advocacy communities and the policy people. And they helped, frankly, our policy people ratchet up their courage. And the treaty that came out of Paris was, frankly, one that exceeded all the expectations in the months leading up to it. So that's one area. Another area was in my Africa advisor was a young woman who was amazing. She had studied African religion at Harvard Divinity School. She had worked at the Department of Defense in the Bush administration and had helped launch Africa Command in Stuttgart, Germany. And then she came to work for me because of her government experience, her experience in Africa, and her knowledge of African religion. And she was following the election in Nigeria, which took place, I guess it was September of 2015, where they had a successful election. The president left. When he left, his oil minister left town with $6 billion in his pocket. Now, I don't know how you do that. That's a big suitcase. You know, you've got to have somebody helping you transfer money electronically. But Nigeria was basically a corrupt state, and they had a new Muslim president who was elected who had three priorities. One was defeating Boko Haram, one was taking care of a failing economy, and the third was to eliminate public corruption. So what she did is she dragged me to Lagos, Nigeria, which is an amazing place. If you ever have a chance to go to Lagos, go. But we ran a two-day seminar for 40 Muslim and Christian leaders who among their congregations, were over a million people. And we brought in African-centered anti-corruption or transparency organizations to help train imams and Christian pastors on how to clean up their congregational finances. Just to give you one example, one of the metrics we got was that there are more Christian pastors in Nigeria with private airplanes than in the United States.
Just like here at Floris.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. Exactly.
Now, so why we're located so close to Dulles. That's one of the...
Well, yeah. So I asked one of the guys at a break who had a great sense of humor, Christian pastor. I said, no, really, come on. What's up with the airplanes? He said, and with a totally straight face, he said, well, you know, we have very bad roads in Nigeria. And then he burst out laughing because he obviously... So what we did is we helped these senior leaders get some education, and we introduced them to an African-based fiscal transparency organization that will come in and audit your books and teach you accounting practices and best practices, and they'll give you a seal of approval from this NGO for 1 year, and they say your finances meet international standards of accounting. And then we introduced them to another NGO, and these guys were a bunch of 27, 28-year-old Nigerian techies. And they came up with an app for iPhone, where we might be able to use this in the United States sometime, but that'd be another night's story. So you could tap in the equivalent of your zip code, and what would pop up would be a list of appropriate construction appropriations from the national legislature. And see, this is where the problem would be. The legislators would appropriate all this money, and then the money would go into their pocket, and the hospitals were never built, the roads were never built. So you put in your zip code, and it would print out all the appropriations bills for your zip code that had been passed in their Congress the last year, and with the address. So you could go to that empty field and take a picture of the quote-unquote school that wasn't there. And then it would give you the email address of your local representative who voted for that. So you could say, "Dear Congressman Berlin, here's a picture of our hospital that you voted for $20 million. And guess what? You see the grass growing here." So it was an accountability mechanism. Now, in both cases, the expertise we gave them were Africans. It wasn't the United States government coming in and wagging a finger and preaching a sermon about how we're just so much smarter than you guys. These guys formed then their own interreligious NGO. They have held subsequent workshops in the center of the country and in the north of the country, and it's leveraging the moral voices of Muslim and Christian communities to hold public officials accountable. Now, they've drafted also a list of recommended projects, like before you admit somebody in, before you as a pastor admit a public official into membership, they have to renounce public corruption. As you know, we hear traditionally when a new member comes, you ask them to do five things. Well, they've added a sixth thing for mayors and city councilors and elected representatives to say that you renounce public corruption and you will not cheat the people of Nigeria in your professional office, or they won't admit you to these member congregations. So we discovered that churches and mosques, at least in Nigeria, have a tremendously powerful moral voice if they will use it, if they will come together. So this line of effort is still going on. Again, the U.S. government doesn't run it, we don't fund it, but we convened a group of leaders who had a sense of, we need to do something, but nobody can get us in the same room and help us figure it out. But my Africa religion advisor helped build this program, which is still now running on its own. I think the last thing I would say is the refugee space, and we may talk about that more. But in the U.S. today, the State Department pays for the first 90 days of a refugee's life in the United States. And we don't do the work ourselves, but we contract with 9 implementing agencies or partners. 6 of those 9 agencies are faith-based.
So like Church World Service.
Church World Service, the Catholic Charities, the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society, Episcopal Immigration Ministries, and World Relief, which is the evangelical group.
And so Church World Service, for instance, is one that the United Methodist Church is a part of, and that's been in place since probably 1954. These are not new organizations
that
he's talking about. This is refugee problem. It's not a new issue. It's just sort of who are the refugees now. And so anyway, you're with those organizations.
So I traveled. That gave me a warrant to get on a plane, and I have visited 7 resettlement centers here in the United States. And I went to the faith-based ones to see how they do what they do. And since at 9/11, as you can imagine, the number of refugees admitted to the U.S. went down to 0, and that made perfect sense. But in the intervening years, Congress has established a cap. For a while, it was 70,000 a year. Last year, they moved it to 85,000. And this year, they had agreed to take it to 110,000. I think a majority of refugees resettled in the U.S. today are actually resettled by faith-based groups. And they do a remarkable, so it's a remarkable partnership between the U.S. government and these private refugees.
What percentage are resettled by faith-based?
I think it's probably over 50. So 6 of the 9 agencies that do it are faith-based.
Right.
I wish I had the actual numbers, but my suspicion is that indeed the faith-based 6 probably resettle a majority of the 100% every year here. And so these are amazing organizations. They work. Now what they do, the amount of money the State Department puts down is a frighteningly paltry sum. And these faith-based groups multiply it by 10 with their own money in order for somebody to successfully integrate into American society. So those are sort of three issue areas. I think the climate, anti-corruption, and refugee work are just three that come to my mind in terms of some successful initiatives.
Great. Yeah, that's so interesting. And frankly, it's just nice to hear people whose faith is dear to them being motivated and serving in smart ways to make things happen. That's just such a hopeful thing for me.
And what I saw was innovation. Yeah. You know, so if you're running a refugee resettlement center, I was in Des Moines, Iowa, and in Des Moines, of all the seven I went to, it may have been the most interesting there, because it really takes a whole community to successfully resettle refugees. You've got to have a police department that knows how to relate to these refugee communities. You need school systems that know how to take kids. And I remember the most amazing person I probably met in all those travels was the school superintendent of the Des Moines, Iowa school system. And I think, if I remember right, he's got 34,000 students in his district, and I think 8,000 of them are either refugee kids or children of refugees.
Wow.
And he told me this one story where a few years ago, a 15-year-old girl from Burma was presented by her parents on the first day of school to the high school. It was 9th grade through 12th grade. She knew no English, and she had never been in a formal education institution. And they sort of said bye-bye, and they got in the car and drove away. And now the principal has a refugee coordinator for the entire school system because this has become normal. In one academic year, so they pre-tested her, and they had somebody who could translate for her. So she took the sort of a pre-test, an assessment, preschool assessment, and I think she tested her aptitude with something like at the 4th grade level. And in 1 year, they moved her, I think it was to 8th grade performance. And at the end of the year, they're high-fiving each other, you know, to take this young woman. Now, it's a tribute to her skill and her capacity. She basically went 3 or 4 grades in 1 year. But by the standards of the Iowa State education system, she was a failure because she was not performing at grade level.
But it was a good year.
It was a great year. Yeah. It was a phenomenal year. And so this superintendent said, I will not accept the label of failure for the work that we did. And so the innovation that's going on in that space is not here in Washington, D.C., but it's coming from cities and towns coming together to figure out how are we going to transform these kids from refugees into citizens and taxpayers. And I saw this all over the country. It was just mind-boggling, the level of energy.
So, Shaun, let me move the direction of the conversation to this issue of deeper conversations. And you've done this on a global scale. I'm thinking about it in terms of the micro, you know, conversations that, you know, we're going to have with our neighbors here in Fairfax County. If you had to give us advice on how to have a deeper conversation about religion, what are some guidelines, what are some pieces of advice that you'd offer us?
One of the things we did a lot of in our office is that my work as a religion scholar told me that we make this distinction in the religion field between official religion and lived religion. Mm-hmm. So in other words, if somebody wants to understand what's going on at Floris and they only interview Tom Berlin, they're going to get a view, they're going to get a perspective, but they're not going to get the view of a person in the pew. And in a church this large, for instance, on any given Sunday, you know you've got congregants here who've had the best week of their life. And you know you've got congregants who've just had the worst week of their life. And 2,000 stops in between. You don't know all, you know some of those stories, but to really capture it, you've got to talk to rank and file. So historically what we've done, I think in the U.S. government, we've talked only to what I call the big hat leaders. And you get a perspective, and it's informative and it's interesting, but you may not get the slightest understanding of what's actually going on the ground. So we would talk to people. When I would go to a country, I would meet with the big hat leaders. But then the embassy would set up just regular rank-and-file conversations with people, and we would try to analyze both sets of data. So we developed a kind of, okay, how do you talk to the senior leader, but then how do you have real conversations with people who live in different religious communities? And they weren't that different. Mm-hmm. But I think the first thing is you have to show up and you have to be willing. You know, if you just sit there and do the one of our favorite movies is The Sound of Music, and some of you may remember the main character who tries to teach band to students with the think system. No, I'm sorry, Music Man, I'm sorry, yeah, thank you, this is why, yeah.
And this is why you bring your spouse.
Exactly.
This is it, right here.
Yeah, people are looking at me like, Sound of Music? No, Music Man, thank you, where the Robert Preston character sells band instruments but he can't teach music, and he fakes his way through it. You can't fake your way through this. You first of all, you got to show up, and you have to be prepared. You have to learn a little bit beforehand so you know the right questions to ask. But I think also you have to know why. What's the goal of the conversation? Are you there? Why are you having the conversation? There is, at least in the global world, a professional interreligious industry where I could have been every week in a different European city in a 5-star hotel eating amazing food, seeing the same 150 interreligious folk who would sign the same sort of highfalutin peace, love, and joy documents, and then I'll see you next week in London, or I can't wait to see you in Paris. So there is this professional thing, and I hated that. I learned nothing. So I stopped doing that. Instead, I would go to countries, I would try to meet as many religious leaders and as many rank and file members of different faith communities. But you have to show up, you have to be prepared, and here's where it gets hard. Not everybody's happy with America. Not everybody's happy with Christians.
I've heard that.
Yeah, and yeah. So if I land, now you Google me, and I discovered they have Google around the world. Mm-hmm. I thought it was just here, but no, actually they have it internationally. So you Google me, and I'm Christian. I mean, there's no way you can tell. So I had real anxiety. What happens when I meet with Buddhist leaders or Muslim leaders or Jewish leaders? Are they gonna say, I can't talk to you because we think you're some sort of crusading Christian? But I found out they were very happy that the U.S. government sent somebody who could be respectful of other religious leaders. I remember I went into Jerusalem the first time, and I met the Roman Catholic Patriarch there. And he was not a particularly happy guy because the Catholic Church has shrunk and is really under a lot of pressure in Israel and in the Middle East. And I walk into this room, he's got 8 Irish priests as his advisors. I'm not sure why you choose Irish priests to be your advisor. Anyway, I walk into this room and he comes up to me and he says, Dr. Casey, it's so great to meet you. I've been waiting for you for 40 years. Now there was the parable, right? Our government had not shown up, at least from Washington, to talk to, even though we've been in negotiations in that part of the world for a very long time. So what you have to do is what I call playing the pinata. I mean, sometimes if you're a Christian, even here in Northern Virginia, and you want to talk to somebody of a different religion, they may not be particularly happy with how they think of American Christians have treated either their country or their community here. And I had to learn how not to be defensive and to what I call play the pinata and sometimes listen to the criticism in order to get to the real conversation. So I think you have to be prepared sometimes for people to be reticent, maybe even be unhappy with how they feel like they've been treated, either by the American government or American people or Christian groups. And if you really want to have a conversation, you've got to go through that phase and not be defensive. But then you have to be hospitable and you have to be humble. And you have to ask really good questions and listen.
And learning can be the motivating issue. Like you said, you need a reason. So in our world, I find that I can have a conversation with almost anyone of a different faith tradition if I simply say, can you help me understand more about what you believe? But that starts at that posture of right. Humility and learning.
One of the things we did a bit of in Iraq, as you know, in the Muslim world, there in many places is a divide between Sunni and Shia. And I had 3 literally internationally renowned scholars who came to work for me who know the Sunni-Shia divide. And again, I don't pretend to know anything about that. But one of them said to me that in certain parts of Iraq today where there is tension, now historically there have been times when Sunni and Shia have gotten along famously in Iraq, but not so much in recent years. He made the observation, if you're living in a village and there's no water, Sunni and Shia are both thirsty. If there's no electricity, Sunni and Shia are both in the dark. And we tried to run some lines of effort around common frustrations about life in their particular location. And if you bring people together across religious divides, not to talk about who's the rightful successor to the prophet, Sunni or Shia, but can we do something about the lack of elementary education for our children? Can we do something in terms of getting the power grid rebuilt? Sometimes you build trust across deep religious divisions indirectly by working together towards common goals and common objectives. If we had gone in and said, okay, listen, we're going to set up a seminar and we're going to help you rectify this great divide within Islam that goes back to the 7th century because we're going to bring in some handlers and some good conflict mediating people, no one would have come and it would not have been successful. But by virtue of getting at common areas of deprivation, we could sometimes then build conversation and build social capital and trust between religious groups working on these common issues that affect them all. So you think about here in Fairfax County, there are lots of public issues, the schools, the high price of commuting. There are ways of talking to your neighbor that then may help you build some trust and that then can allow you to have a relationship that gets into some of these deeper questions about, well, how is your life or view of the world different from mine as a Christian and you happen to be Hindu or something?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, if you read the text of these religions, you find, take education, for example, you will find support for education, for instance. You'll find support for the issue that's common to all, and that can be a starting point. So what's lost if we don't have these deeper conversations with people of other faith traditions?
I think you lose several things. I've done some reading, for instance, in the city of Boston, there have been people ask, how did the Boston area after the marathon bomber a couple of years ago? I mean, that could have split into an open conflict between Christians and Muslims, because the bombers did have, you know, they came from Chechnya, they had Islamic relation, and it didn't happen. Boston was not divided, there were not religious wars that broke out. And part of the answer was people had spoken, they knew their neighbors, and these religious minorities were not isolated and completely ghettoized. They were well situated in the larger social fabric of Boston and its suburbs. So if you don't know your neighbor, the time to meet your neighbor and work together productively is not when your block is on fire, right? It's hard to build a deep friendship in the face of crisis. So what you lose resilience in your communities. So that if a problem arises, and I've never taken the time to talk to my neighbors two doors down because they're not Christian, they're a member of another group, there's going to be no resilience between us in terms of conflict or when crisis arises. That's number one. Number two, one of the amazing things I think in our time here in Fairfax County has been the amazing diversity in our public schools. And at least our family's experience was the schools did a very good job of welcoming diversity, seeing diversity religiously as a resource and not a problem to be solved. And it was incredible to see, particularly on the soccer field. I mean, I have friends who say, if you want to cure religious conflict in the world, just start roll out soccer balls on the ground and make sure all the teams are interreligious in composition. Now, there's some truth to that, I think. But here in Fairfax County, I think we have this kind of resilience where nobody looks out at the girls on the soccer field and says, well, okay, I see X number of this religion, I see X number of that religion. We see a diverse team out there playing well, and usually the other team they're playing is also equally diverse. And I think we have found a way. And that's one of the great things about our public schools. Now, I don't pretend that it's not hard, but given the, in the 16, 17 years we've lived here, we've seen a growing form of religious and ethnic pluralism here. And the public schools, I think, are one site where you can't ignore that fact. And certainly in our family's experience, we didn't sense religious tension. In fact, we saw amazing friendships. Our two kids had friendships across an amazing array of religious diversity, and I believe they're stronger for it. I grew up in a segregated public school system through the first four grades of my education between black and white in the South, and we didn't have any, the kind of resilience in McCracken County, Kentucky, when I was a kid, compared to what Fairfax County has. So we lose that, I think, if we're not willing to. So I think our children sometimes do a much better job talking to their friends who are of different religions than the adults often do.
You mentioned the Boston bombing, and since 9/11, perhaps even before, many Americans hold a great suspicion of Islam. But I think there's another story that's not told, which is Islamic leaders, Muslim leaders, who are really working to undo terrorism and extremism in their own community, the same way Christian leaders would in Christian community, but also who are really just genuine people of peace. An example I would give, I believe it's tonight at the Adams Center in Fairfax. I think tonight's the night that they're holding a forum. It was today, right? So a forum with local Jewish leaders on the Holocaust, and it was a Holocaust remembrance. Well, holding that, obviously, at the Adams Center, which is a Muslim center, is very important, you know, in our community. So I'm betting that that's happening across the globe, but it feels less represented to me. And can you help us have some insight on that?
So let me start sort of in my office. One of the first things we did was bring together three existing offices in the State Department that dealt in some fashion with religion. So the department had a special representative to Muslim communities, and it was a three-person office. We brought that office into mine. We have a special envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism, and that office was brought into mine. And we have an office of the special envoy to the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, which is a 57-member majority Muslim country. I call it a trade association. That's not quite right. So those three existing offices came in under me. So I had, over the course of 3.5 years, I had 8 Muslim staffers working for me, from young to middle-aged. And we had as much understanding of global Islam and local Islam as any other office in the federal government. So we work these issues a lot. Now, Imam Majid, who is the senior imam at Dulles, or the Adams, all Dulles area Muslim society, was a great partner of ours, both domestically and internationally. He was part of a group of Muslim leaders, 120 scholars around the world, that came together and wrote what's called the Marrakesh Declaration, which came out, I think it was probably about 9 months ago. So he is one of an American Muslim scholar and leader who's done work locally here in Fairfax County, but he's also participated in some of these global Muslim convenings where they advocate nonviolence. They absolutely reject any form of Muslim violence as being anti-Islamic. And there are all kinds of movement, both at the grassroots level around the world, but also globally, where Muslim leaders are coming together and they're absolutely rejecting any notion of Muslim-based violence against any other faith group or towards other Muslim groups. There are 1.6 billion Muslims around the world, and the overwhelming majority of those folks reject any form of religiously or Islamically inspired violence. But you don't read about them. The American media doesn't cover it very much. They have trouble getting attention for the work that they do. But we spent countless hours trying to support that kind of work, shining a light on it, trying to promote it. And the reality is that the Muslim world, broadly drawn, is a peace-loving community, and they're working very, very hard to tamp out those spaces where there are religiously motivated, violent folk doing the things that we are aware about in terms of the headlines. So we had, both domestically and internationally, an amazing number of efforts trying to get exactly at this. But there are a lot of stereotypes out there. There's a lot of stereotyping about Muslims, both in the United States and around the world. It's going to be a long-term project to engage in educating, and it's not going to be something that's solved in short order here, particularly in the United States.
I think that stereotype issue, I hadn't really put that word to it, but this is one of the reasons this Deeper Conversation series was important to me. I feel like we operate in a lot of stereotypes, and that's not just Christians towards other religions, that's other religions towards Christians. And there's plenty, on the historical record, there's just plenty of bad behavior by everybody. And so sometimes that, but I'll tell you, when I made that joke earlier about when you sit on an airplane and the seatmate says, "What do?" and you say you're a pastor, I want to tell you, you can feel the stereotype go up. And I'm great with that. I've been living with that for a long time. But I don't want to live in a space where I'm doing that to other people. Because frankly, it really cuts out a lot of great moments in life when we live in that space. So I'm glad to hear that there was an active work, you know, in the State Department to sort of deal with that on a large scale. Remember, I said to you earlier, you may have questions that you want to ask. In just a few minutes, we're going to start collecting those. So put your hand way up in the air. So there are people behind you who want to see your hands, and they're going to hand that. So it's not whether I see you, it's whether they see you. So just keep your hand up for a while, and we'll all do that. Seeing that there's a lot of interest, I want to make sure we get to that space. Okay, tell us about some of those interesting people that you got to meet, because frankly, you got to meet some really interesting people, and I really am glad to hear that you've met with people that are the rank and file members of various faith traditions, but let's face it, we all want to hear a story about somebody really cool.
Yeah. Well, so when you told me to start thinking about that question, it was just, you know, where do I begin? And I thought, well, I met the Pope last month, and which is really quite remarkable. I helped John Kerry in particular build, I think, some of the deepest relationships the U.S. government's ever had with the Vatican. And I was with him when he made his first trip. I was with him when he made his last trip. And on the last trip, we got him an appointment with the Pope, which is hard to do. Let me just say that. You can't just dial up the Pope and say, "Hey, I want to bring my boss next Tuesday. Do you have a slot?" You know. Anyway, so I was very proud we worked that out. And there are a couple things, and again, I grew up in a small one-horse town, okay? I mean, I grew up in a town of 3,000, or I was born into a town of 3,000 people, and so there are a lot of times I would pinch myself and say, you know, it is a long way from Kennett, Missouri to the Vatican City, right? And I had one of those moments, so we're up in the, you know, you travel and you go through all these ornate rooms, and finally you find yourself outside the Pope's door. And the door opens up and Kerry goes in, and the way the script is written, he's gonna be in there one-on-one for 30 minutes, and then I get to go in with two other U.S. government people. Now, the whole time you're thinking,
okay, aren't you thinking right now, and your pastor? Like, couldn't that have happened? Couldn't that? Or his spouse, right? Anne's got a hand up too. So right. Anne and I will be forming a line over here after this to discuss it. But okay, continue. Sorry.
So I'm thinking, what do you say to the Pope? Now, I get paid to talk. I've been a college professor. I'm a diplomat. You're paid to talk. So hold that thought. I've been working on a speech, right? So we're sitting there, and luckily I did not say this out loud because they would have thrown me out. I looked at the wall, and I said to myself, those are two amazing reproductions of an El Greco. And then I thought, you moron, those are originals.
That is El Greco,
right?
Yeah.
It's like, I'm not in the men's furnishings at Macy's in the mall. I mean, I am looking at two just stunning El Greco. So luckily I didn't say that out loud. But then they ring a bell, which means like in 30 seconds, the door's gonna open up and they're gonna throw you in with the Pope. And sure enough, the door opens up, they throw me in, and my mind goes blank. I have no memory of what I babbled to Pope Francis. Your tongue gets big and your mouth gets dry. And
please tell me you did not say, nice hat.
No.
Please tell me.
No, no,
please tell me
no,
you did not
no.
say that.
Well, I may have. I seriously, I have this memory of looking down and shaking his hand and shaking my head a lot and thinking, this was not the speech I had prepared. I don't know where that went. But it was phenomenal because I will say he, in person, he radiates the warmth and joy that you see, that you read about, when you read his speeches and you read his books. He's just one of those amazing human beings that you, when you're in his presence, you say, wow, this guy is the real deal. And then there's one picture, which I don't think I got a copy of, where they took a photo, then and the press comes in. Now, many times I've been on the side when the press rushes Secretary Kerry, they take pictures and things, but John Kerry's on one side, the Pope is in the middle, and I'm on the other side. And the international press comes in, and I'm like, I'm not supposed to be here. And that was a pretty wild experience. But he gave us gifts, and we spoke, probably spoke for a total of, you know, 7-8 minutes, and then they sort of send us the signal, it's time, he's a busy guy.
Well, I know you've got respect for him, as others do. The Pope's been also trying to work on relationships across religions.
Yes.
And also dealing with, I think it's appropriate to say, issues of corruption in his own church that
That's
he's been
right.
working at. And all faith communities have to deal with issues of malfeasance or corruption because, unfortunately, we are full of humans. And so that's another piece that we share. What's one of, when you interact with Americans, and you've done this as a professor and you've done it now with the State Department, and you have lived in the United States your whole life, so you deal with a lot of us, what are some of the biggest information gaps that you think Christians carry? Speak about our own context here as Christians, about other faith traditions. What are some of our biggest gaps?
Yeah, this is really interesting. America is becoming more complex and more pluralistic religiously. Whether you can celebrate that, you can lament that, it's just a fact. And I was flying home to see my mother lives in Paducah, Kentucky, which is a town of like 20,000 people. And you have to go to Chicago to get there. And I got on the little puddle jumper plane. And Paducah now has maybe, you know, 20,000 people. And I suddenly noticed in this tiny plane, I think 15 of the people on my plane were young Muslim families with their small children. And I wouldn't say, you must be on the wrong airplane. There's no way you guys are going to my hometown.
Yeah.
And I land and they get off and they're met by family. So they actually
sure.
were going there. Mm-hmm. And come to find out, there's an Islamic center of Paducah, Kentucky. Now, if you had told me when I left at 18 in the last millennium from Paducah to go to college that someday there would be an Islamic center of Paducah, Kentucky, I would have said, you're out of your minds. This would never be the case. And so the big debate in town was, do they let the local imam into the clergy association? And they were still deliberating on that one. But I think the gap is both one of knowledge, but it's also an empathy gap that I think a lot of us are afraid, and because of the seeing, you know, a Buddhist community or a Hindu community or a Muslim community that might be growing nearby us, there's still some fear and some distance, and what I call is reticence. I don't think there's angry feelings necessarily towards the growing pluralism in our neighborhoods. I think it's just kind of reticence. Like, I really, what would I say? How do I knock on that door? How do I have a conversation? And I think it's that reticence that leads us not to be empathetic and not curious about what their lives are like. And it turns out, I remember, you may remember this, there were studies back when I was in junior high that they would do opinion surveys in the United States during the Cold War about, do you think Russian parents love their children as much as American parents do? Mm. And there was always a gap. You know, I don't know, it was like 20 or 30% or something where Americans would say they love their kids 20% less than we do. And it was distance, it was fear. I think there's some of that today that Christians possess towards their neighbors that don't happen to be Christian. Mm-hmm. And I guess I'm here to say, I think that's too bad. In my experience, Muslim parents love their children as much. Now, I had Muslim colleagues working for me. They care about their children's education. They care about the cost of commuting in Fairfax County. They want the schools to be good schools. They
don't mind me.
Thank you. And so there's an empathy gap that also leads to, I think, an understanding and an information gap. And we as Christians are called to love our neighbors as ourselves. I see that as an activity, not a passive thing. That's an active thing. Yeah. I think we're called to understand.
So let me turn to some of your questions. And thank you for the volunteer who ran and got my glasses. You're about to hear all the questions Tom could read. And it's a big handwriting that's about to be rewarded. But now we've got a broader array of possibilities. I've been hearing about the persecution, this person asked, I've been hearing about the persecution of 90,000 Christians in 2016. I'm not sure where that comes from. And they're asking, is this accurate? And what's the role of the U.S. government to help them?
I don't know about the veracity of that statistic. I'd love to know where that came from. It is certainly true. I think the last statistic I saw was that ISIL had killed 50,000 people. That was a UN statistic, and that was probably a year ago. That number has probably gone up. A majority of the victims of ISIL are Muslim. Now, that's not to say that Christians have it easy. They do not have it easy there. One of the proudest moments for working for Secretary Kerry was when he did, in fact, declare that, in his opinion, Christians, Yazidis, and Shia Muslims were the victims of genocide at the hands of ISIL. So right now, in that particular neighborhood, let me tell you what we are doing, or well, what we had been doing as a government. I can't speak as a government at this point, obviously. We have flown, our Air Force, or our air power has flown thousands of missions and sorties to degrade ISIL. ISIL now is far less powerful numerically. I won't quote specific numbers because I don't have the current up-to-date ones, but certainly a majority of ISIL fighters have been eliminated. American air power is convening. I guess we're collaborating with a coalition now of over 60 nations in that fight. They're on the run, they're on the retreat. We're in the process of trying to liberate the city of Mosul, which is a city of perhaps a million people. And I think it's reasonable to expect sometime in the next calendar year, we will liberate Mosul, which is sort of the last large city they have in northern Iraq. The United States pays, I think we spend now up to $6 billion to support refugees in place who have fled ISIL in Iraq and in Syria. Right now, there are more displaced human beings around the planet than at any other time in human history. I think even larger than World War II. There's something like 65 million people displaced globally. 21 million of those or so are refugees. And to be a refugee, you have to cross an international boundary, fleeing for your life. Then we have what are called internally displaced people who've moved within the same country but have not crossed. There are over 40 million of them. The United States has contributed over $6 billion into the UN system that takes care of the refugee set. And we are the largest donor to that. So anyone who says, now there are people who say we've done nothing to support Christians. That's just not true. You know, we're flying military flights. We have in Turkey, in Jordan, in Lebanon, we are paying about 50 cents on the dollar that are being spent in the refugee space in that area to support Muslims and Christians and anyone who has fled. And we have been admitting Christians as part of our refugee process until very recently. So it is true that going back to our original invasion of Iraq, the Christian population in the Middle East has been under tremendous pressure over, what was that? That was 2003. So for about the last decade and a half, Christians have in fact been under tremendous pressure, and we have responded literally with billions of dollars and a lot of military force to try to stave off the attacks and the persecution, not just of Christians, but of also Muslims and groups like the Yazidis. You know, there are a number of smaller religious minorities that have also been on the receiving end of ISIL in particular.
So a number of people have asked a similar question. Will the new administration continue the work of the office that you started?
That's to be determined.
Yeah.
The transition from one administration to another is always complex and long. On good days, I think they will. On bad days, I think they won't. And the truth is, we'll know probably another 7 or 8 months whether they continue this or not.
Some of you have asked multiple questions. And some of you have not really asked questions. You've just put question marks after a statement. And so part of my job is to sort that out, and that's why it takes me just a minute. So come on, y'all. You know better than that.
Right? So let me tell you a story. One of my heroes in this town, you know, I've done, the other day I actually counted up, I've done over 100 panel discussions in the last 16 years, which embarrasses me that I've wasted that much of my life doing that. But I have a friend one time who was doing this, and he's very good at it, and he chided the audience. He said, and please try to disguise your comments as a question. And I think that works, right?
Yeah, I need to remember that. How do you balance, because religion is a factor of the refugee situation and the immigration situation, this person asked, how do you balance security with openness to immigrants?
So this is a great question. And the truth is, I don't want a violent person moving in next door to me, right? And if we were to ask people in this, nobody wants somebody flying in from another country who's going to start creating violence in your neighborhood. Having said that, a refugee goes through the most complex, lengthy security process to get into the United States of any other class of human beings. It's basically a 2-year process from the time you raise your hand and identify yourself to the United Nations saying, I am a refugee. For religious reasons, I have fled country X, I am now in country A, and I want to be, you have to be, first of all, given an official designation by the UN, which means you have to meet objective criteria to be labeled a refugee. Less than 2% of refugees like that actually end up leaving a camp they first go to and being relocated. The first priority of the UN system is to resettle you back where you came from. The average length of stay in a United Nations refugee camp now is over 17 years. Now, I met a man in Dallas, Texas 2 years ago who was on day 4 of his arrival in the U.S. He had spent 21 years in an Eritrean refugee camp. Now, if you're from Dallas, I apologize in advance. I've lived in West Texas, so I think I'm Dallas would not be where I would choose if I could just pick any place around the world. We'll talk afterwards. I apologize. But this man thought Dallas, Texas was utopia. He had a job mopping and sweeping up office parks from the graveyard shift, and he had to take like 3 buses to get there and 3 buses to get home. And he told me with tears in his eyes, I love America because I get to work with my hands and I get to support my family. I don't have to rely on being in a camp. So the people who get here, the precious few out of the 20 some odd million refugees, the 70,000 to 80,000 who make it here every year, of course, right now we're on pause, they have gone through a security vetting that includes the FBI, that includes the Department of Homeland Security and the United Nations. You can't fake your way through that system. And if you can't meet the security bar, you don't come. Now, this is one of the greatest. Everywhere I go, I had a guy tell me, a very smart guy I know in Dallas, said, "Shaun, you guys are handing out free one-way tickets from Syria to Dallas, Texas." And I said, what would it take to convince you you're wrong? Because from the president on down to everybody who works in the State Department, our worst nightmare is that terrorists get on planes on the U.S. government's dime and come to the United States, okay? And we have set up the most vigorous security process that can be done. Now, again, don't take my word for it. The current administration is currently looking at that. They've got 120 days to do that, and we'll see what they come up with. But the security piece of that is fundamental. And we've brought 3 million refugees into the United States since 1975. And my bet is that their criminal activity in those 25 years is better than a random sample of 3 million American citizens who've been here the whole time. Okay. Now, you can't guarantee 100%. I don't know what I'm going to do in 10 years. I may go crazy and do something. Nobody's responsible for my behavior. Nobody can predict my behavior. But to the greatest extent possible, we have a security process in place that works very, very well.
Average time in a refugee camp, how many years?
17 years. And it's getting longer. It's not getting shorter.
Yeah. I was in Jordan a year ago, I guess, where people have lived in that country. What, about 6 million people, have about 1 million refugees.
That's correct.
Living there. And the length of time in those camps is just unbelievable. So that you're telling me that's just the world over.
And the Jordanians are really quite remarkable. I mean, the stability of their country is now in question because of the sheer number of refugees they have.
This is a question I didn't anticipate, and it's just sort of interesting. If you're in your office staff, did you include agnostics, atheists, or even ethical culturalists? Millennials are often a-religious, yet, generationally, you'd want people to be part of work.
Well, first of all, it's illegal for me to say, well, are you A, B, C, D, E, or F? Okay. I mean, you can't hire the federal government on the basis of religion. Okay, that's number one. So, but the question I would ask of people is, can you tell me experience you have working with different religious communities? Now, some of the smartest people I know in understanding religion are atheists. And I wish I could tell you there was a correlation between your depth of Methodist spirituality and your ability to understand Islam. But I've been searching for that. I'm 59 and 365th. Today. I'm almost 60. I can't find that correlation. Some of the smartest people I know have never had a particularly pious thought in their lives with respect to religion. So what I did, what we ended up with, take the four principals, the four leaders and my chief of staff, the five of us. There's one Christian, two Jews, two Muslims. But the answer to your question, yes, I had people who I'm not sure, on my staff, I'm not sure ever had a religious personal thought in their lives. And that's I was looking for their brain power and their experience and their understanding and training. So I didn't care if how pious you happen to be or how irreligious. I wanted to know what's your experience, what is your knowledge, and can you help me interact with religious communities? And sometimes my most powerful gifted interlocutors of religious groups were people who themselves were not particularly religious. So I had all kinds, but during the interview process, I can't say, well, how many times have you been to Sunday school in the last 12 months? Once we got a staff, we had amazing conversations. I have some deeply pious Jewish staffers and Muslim staffers and Christian staffers, but I also have thoroughgoing secular people. But what I insisted on was respect. Now, if the Office of Religion and Global Affairs couldn't model respect and conversation and toleration, how could we possibly do this around the world? So I insisted on respect of diversity and a treatment of people that modeled that. But so the answer to your question is yes, on our staff, but then also the Secular Humanist Coalition came and interacted with us a lot. Because to be honest, There were people who were afraid that this office was just going to be an indirect promotion of Christianity. So there were a number of people who came in and said, well, who is on your staff? Who do you meet with? In 3.5 years, we met with every group that wanted to come and meet with us where we could find a common time on our calendars to meet. From far right to far left, from secular to conservative Christian, Muslim, Jewish, Hindu, you name it. In fact, I met with some religious groups I didn't even know existed until I got into the State Department. Yeah. So we being radically inclusive was part of our commitment.
Yeah. Shaun, I'm gonna stop there and just want to say thank you so much for this generous time. I think we're all very grateful and appreciative. So
it's been great fun for me. Thank you all.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Lord, thank you for this night, and thank you for people like Shaun and others who serve in public spaces with a heart of goodwill, a desire to love their neighbor, a desire to care for the world, and a desire to bring the best of the things that you have led us to understand about ourselves as Christ followers into a broader conversation with leaders of other faith communities. Thank you for his ability to stand in that conversation and to do it with a heart of peace. And bless us that we might have a heart of peace, but also have eyes to see and ears to hear, remembering the call of justice and righteousness in the prophets and from the mouth of Christ himself. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.